The days today aren't great, but you know, back when the studios had all the stars. I'm told that in her collection, she has the original set from The Tonight Show. And I can't for the life, was that with Jerry Lester on Broadway Open House, or was it The Tonight Show with Steve Allen? Well, Carson's been out here since 72. Oh, you mean his set from New York? How the hell did she get that out here? Because that thing was large back in 30 Rock. Anyway, she's got all that stuff. We don't have the old set of The Tonight Show here tonight for obvious reasons. There's no sense starting a war. But we do have some other things that will amaze and astound you. And a little bit later on, we have Mr. Bob Blumhoff and Bob Lewin. Mr. Blumhoff is with the American Film Institute. It's known around the country, I guess, as AFI. And they do award shows once a year on television, and they salute great people in Hollywood. They've done John Ford. They have done Henry Fonda. I believe Alfred Hitchcock will receive their... I beg your pardon?
They did Cagney.
I don't want to mention the whole list of 35 years, just one or two. The American Film Institute Award next year will go to Alfred Hitchcock. Anyway, Mr. Blumhoff is here tonight, and Bob Lewin, who is with the Television Academy. And they are interested in preserving old motion pictures. Did you know that some of the classic movies that all of us have enjoyed over the years were shot on something called nitrate film? And this stuff, when exposed to the elements, bubbles and eventually self-combusts, and the old movies are lost. And what they're trying to do now is find these nitrate films before they disintegrate and transfer them to more stable media so that we can preserve some of the great motion pictures that have come before, rather than have them simply disappear and disintegrate. And then a little bit later on, we have some film clips for you. We have 40 seconds from Pearl White and 35 seconds from Bob Steele. These are old, old silent trailers, 1917, 1922, something like that. And they will show you what kind of film is being lost if something isn't done about it. And also, Lewin, he worked for the television industry, did he not? And he knows, like here, all the shows that we do and that Carson does and that everybody does, sooner or later they erase all these programs and they're lost forever. Not that all of them are of great moment, but we've had shows here, and I know John has, with people that are dead now, who are giants in this industry. And because you don't have the space to store these videotapes for years and years and years and years, they erase them. I'll tell you a funny story about things that have been erased. I was in an elevator in Rockefeller Center one day, and there was a guy coming down from the 6th floor or the 10th floor, and he had a hand truck filled with great big pieces of brass. And one of the executives in the elevator asked him what those were, and he said, well, these are the original Toscanini masters, the brass masters that they used to stamp the press the 78 Red Seal records back in the 40s when the NBC orchestra was coast to coast. And the guy said, well, what's going on with them? And he said, well, we're taking them to Camden or somewhere to melt them down. Can you believe? And I guess they have to do it for economics and for space, but the stuff that has been put on record and on videotape and on film and is now lost is incredible. So that's what these guys, Lewin and Blumhoff, are interested in, and they will join us here a little bit later on. Now, tomorrow night, ready when I am?
Yeah, ready.
Okay. I want to get to termites, but I'll save that till tomorrow. I'll just give you a tip. There's a guy who lives across the street from me. I have no idea who this is. Now here is Jane Withers, and we're talking about teddy bears.
We sure are.
And she said, do you know about the book about teddy bears? And I mentioned Stephen Bull, because we've had him on.
Oh, that's an incredible book,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah, but now what's the one you've
got? This is a series of stories about bears and teddy bears from 1896. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry I can't think of the author's name.
It's okay.
I'm real tacky about names.
Hey, we'll get
really
50
am.
Telegrams in the morning saying the author was. In fact,
oh, please, if you know the name, send it to us, yes.
Say, now listen, what is this about? What is there to preserve in Hollywood? Isn't it all collected in a museum somewhere, or isn't it all available to the people?
Oh, Tom, that's what it's all about. I mean,
well, because you remember in 1962 out here, they condemned some property near
yes.
the Hollywood Bowl,
yes,
the county of Los Angeles, to build a motion picture museum.
Right.
Then there was talk that Bob Hope was going to build a museum of sorts in the Burbank area.
Right.
Well, haven't any of these plans come to fruition?
Not a single one. But hang in there, fella. It's going to happen.
All right. Now, what have you got and what have other people got that you feel represents the good old time here in Hollywood that people ought to keep, you know?
Well, I've been collecting all my life. And as you know, I'm 52 now, and I started in this business when I was two. Mm-hmm. So I've had a long start ahead of a lot of other folks.
But when did you start collecting all these things?
When I was about, well, really, seriously, about 4 years old. It started with my first teddy bear that I won on the boardwalk in Jacksonville, Florida, that I love very much. And dolls, of course. That's always been my number one hobby. Mm-hmm. But then, of course, because of show business and lovely people, after I became recognized and known as a child star, oh, so many wonderful people would send me lovely gifts from all over the world. Mm-hmm. And I felt that I was only temporary custodian of them because to me, nothing is nice unless it's shared. Mm-hmm. And I love to share everything. Mm-hmm. And I've always shared my doll collection. And then, of course, with movie memorabilia, there were so many special people that I was privileged to meet and know and work with, and people like Will Rogers and Irvin S. Cobb that are no longer with us, but gave me wonderful things. Tom Mix, and oh, gosh, I could go on and on and on and on.
Yeah, but people in the business do exchange things.
Yes, they exchange
and your
gifts,
script, like
and
this,
they share things. Yes.
A little script book that you
just
have
just got
here.
That last week of Judy Garland.
Hold that up.
Okay.
Or let me do it, hon, because I know where the cameras
are. Okay, fine.
And you tell what this is. Well,
all right. I attended the Judy Garland auction last week. I have a lot of personal things that Judy gave me. Not that many, but a few things as we were friends, because we worked together when she was Frances Gumb on a show called the Marco Juvenile Review. Out here, it was the one job that I was assured of once a week on Saturday nights. Mm-hmm. And it was called the Marco Juvenile Review, sponsored by Marco Dog Food. And Judy was on the show as Frances Gumb and her two sisters. Mickey Rooney was on the show as Mickey McGuire of Mickey McGuire Comedies. Mm-hmm. Edith Fellows, Leonard Sue, Sidney Miller was the MC. And I was kind of the female juvenile Milton Berle. I interrupted every act. And I was the real creepy, kind of nuisance-y kind of little girl on the show.
Yeah.
So that did it for me, and we got $6 a performance. So naturally, because of that show, and Mickey Rooney and Judy Garland and Edith, and all of these lovely people that I was privileged to know then, have always been very, very special to me.
Well, the thing we showed here was a
script.
A script from the Ford Star Jubilee in 1955.
That starred Judy Garland.
Exactly.
And now, that I acquired at the Judy Garland auction the other night.
Would it be improper to ask you how much this cost?
I think that particular thing was $375. All of these things that I have collected were not cheap.
No.
No, they were not. They all came from estate sales or, just various things.
But now, where did you pick up the original set for The Tonight Show?
Well, bless their hearts, they gave it to KCET, and I help KECT as much as I can, and all kinds of other organizations. I work for 27 charities mm-hmm. annually, mm-hmm. and KCET just happens to be one of them. And I do better for them when I don't go and auction something off, because you can't buy something when you're there. You have to stay home and buy it, mm-hmm. you know. So I do better for them when I stay home and buy things. So they told me, because they know my love and my sincere desire to preserve movie memorabilia and television memorabilia,
surely.
And vaudeville memorabilia, mm-hmm. too. All of it. They said, we have the original Johnny Carson set. I said, you got to be kidding. So I went down, checked it out, and sure enough, there were the burnt things, the cigarette burns and the desk, the whole schmear. And I thought, my land, what history. Because, well, you realize how many famous people have sat in all those chairs.
You are
it's
kidding.
Just incredible.
Yep.
And again, I felt that must be preserved. So I kept bidding, and two other gentlemen were bidding against me, but I finally got it. And
What'd you lay for that?
A lot.
Really?
A lot, yes. But it helped KCET.
Okay.
It helped KCET.
But where do you have the room and the wherewithal? Because you have to pay storage for all these
tell
things
me
that
about
you have.
It.
I mean, how do you do
and
that?
And it's
for
been
heaven?
Maddening for my children. My five wonderful children have been so kind to put up with me and all of this, you know, because it really becomes quite a problem.
Mm-hmm.
I have seven warehouses for just movie memorabilia. Total warehouses, and then I have a lot of these little mini garages, you know, summer singles. I get a garage from a friend of mine here for. Oh, I collect antique automobiles too, you know, and
you got a Stutz Bearcat?
No, I don't. I'd sure love to have one, though.
So would I, but don't tell me where to find it, folks, because I know how much they cost. Now, they're like 50 or 60 or 70,000.
Oh, well,
fact,
I
keep going.
Have a car. In fact, it's the only one like it in the world. It's the only restored 1913 Regal Underslung, and it's a hoot. Oh, I love it. I just love that car.
Do you drive them?
Well, that one's kind of hard to drive. We did use it once in the Hollywood Parade about 4 years ago. That one and one of my English cars. An and Austin Chummy. And my sons, all of my sons have, you know, they're 6'1", 2", and 3". Mm-hmm. And when they get behind the wheels, their knees are up to their chins.
Right.
And they had me in the back seat. And, oh, boy, howdy, we really had a good time. But I let my mom ride in the Regal. And I hired a driver to who really works with classic automobiles to drive that car so that there wouldn't be any problems. And I wanted my mother to have the privilege of being the first one after I bought that car to ride in that automobile. Mm-hmm.
Now, where do you stand with a museum for all these things? Because you've got stuff, and I'll tell you who else has got stuff. Is
Debbie Reynolds has gravy. She's got a ton of things. You
know, I know
and
she
costumes,
does.
Basically costumes. Debbie and I have talked and shared thoughts so many times, and she has a whole foundation set up for her things. I don't have that yet. And tax-wise, that's what I've got to do very shortly,
mm-hmm.
because it'll be a big help to me, too.
Mm-hmm.
But, she has spent her life collecting costumes. And I have costumes, too, but not half as many as Debbie has. I have total movie sets. Besides the Carson set, I have things from Hello, Dolly. I have things from Desiree. And, backdrops. And I have a wonderful miniature boat. It's really not miniature. It's about 38 feet long, but it's in perfect detail. It was in the Black Swan.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a clipper ship, and it's really extraordinary.
Does it have a motor in or anything? Or?
Oh, no, it was a clipper ship, you know, like a sailing vessel. But
I'm a little dumb.
That's all right.
Say, listen, you know what? I almost had a chance to swipe once.
Oh, what?
At NBC, in the sound department, they had the original. Bum, bum, bum. The box that the announcer hit the chimes with.
Oh, what history that is.
And we used it on a show one night, and I almost got it out the door, and the prop guy came over, and I felt the hand on my shoulder.
Says,
just a second, please. You got to get in line for that one.
But I hope they're really preserving all of these special things. I was amazed, really, when they gave up the Johnny Carson set. I really was. But I'm sure glad I have it, because at least we know it's safe.
I'll tell you what, we could come over to your warehouse and set it up sometime and just make believe. We'll be right back with Jane Withers and more after these words from our NBC stations. I want to ask you about when you made the pictures with Shirley Temple and others, and you were always kind of the heavy. You know what? Not in weight, but in you were the mean little girl,
I have been playing character roles since I was 2 years old.
I know you have.
And I love it. It's so much more fun. It really is.
Yeah, but you weren't the one that got all the goodies at the end.
Oh, well, maybe not in the movie, but I don't know. The roles were very challenging, and they were fun.
Mm-hmm.
And let's face it, I got paid for what most kids got spanked for. For years! And it was really, I enjoyed it. I must say, however, I never really liked to destroy anything or hurt anybody. And just like in Bright Eyes with Shirley, which of course that was the film that really did it for me.
Mm-hmm.
Let's face it, nobody in the world looked like I did. And finally they needed a little girl that was the opposite of Shirley, because every interview I went on for the first 3 years we were out here, you know, they all had the beautiful blonde curls, the little pretty dresses.
Right.
I'd stand out like a sore thumb when I'd go on those interviews, and I thought, now, Mama, please don't get discouraged, because someday they've got to have a little girl that doesn't have blonde curls and
mm-hmm.
frills. And when Bright Eyes came along, of course, that's what did it. And, of course, I was the meanest, creepiest kid in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And in that picture, I had to tear up one of Shirley's dolls. And that really bothered me, because naturally, being a doll collector myself and really appreciating craftsmanship in every possible detail, it really bothered me.
Wasn't it just a prop doll, or was it?
Yeah, it was a prop doll, but still, it was destroying something.
Have you got the doll you ripped up somewhere?
No, I wish I did have. No, but that was before I got my contract with Fox.
Uh-huh.
But after I got my contract with Fox, I had a thing set up with Walter Scott and the gentleman in the prop department that any of the dolls, and I used many, of course, in my films, they were very gracious in letting me have them for my doll collection.
Do you have all the movies that you were in?
I wish I did. No, I only have about 28. I've still got about 36 to go. But Dennis Stenfield, who now is the chairman of the board at 20th Century Fox, I called not too long ago and I said, oh, please, all I want to do is get a print of them so that I can save them for my grandchildren.
Mm-hmm.
And so he was very gracious, and I get maybe one or two prints, you know, whenever they can get the old negatives out of New York or find them, if they haven't been destroyed. I pray they haven't
been
destroyed.
Well, as the fellows that are going to join us will say,
I
a
know.
Lot of these old negatives, they're simply deteriorating now with time, and pictures are being lost. What's the one, the Frank Capra show?
Oh, my
it
goodness.
Happened one night.
Oh, my land. Don't tell me that's destroyed.
Well, no, they have that.
Oh.
But they went to a lot of effort. I don't know if it's that one, but a lot of effort to piece it all together and, you know, get a complete show rather than the edited version for television, which leaves out a lot of stuff.
Sure.
You know?
I do know.
Say, listen, was it hard being a kid star?
It wasn't for me. I loved it.
I know you loved it.
I loved it. I had a ball. I really did. I still do. I thank God every day of my life that my mother wanted to be in show business, because that's how I got into it. She was so determined that I was going to be in show business that she literally used to go and study the marquee, and she'd say, now let's see.
Now where was this that she
this
did?
Was in Atlanta, Georgia,
okay.
Where I'm from. And she said, Withers is a long last name, so she will have to have a short first name to look right on the marquee. Mama was said she never, ever, ever even thought about having a son. It was going to be a girl, and she was going to be successful in show business and bring joy to the world.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I hope I've done that.
Mm-hmm.
I have certainly had a good time in everything I've ever done.
Well, one thing you did that brought a lot of joy to people was Josephine. Now, how did that all happen?
Oh, my
And
man.
Do you clean your own sinks?
Yeah.
And do you use that particular brand?
You bet your boots I do. In fact, I used it for 3 years before I actually started doing Josephine. I had had a chance to do a lot of commercials, and of course, I did 47 films as a child star.
Mm-hmm.
And then I stopped after I got married to have my family, and I did. And then I didn't go back to work at all, except I did make Giant in 1955 because I wanted very much to work with George Stevens. That was like a dream come true for me. I'd always longed to work with him. And that was a great opportunity, and I was very grateful for the opportunity and the role. That was one of my that was my favorite grown-up role,
mm-hmm.
Vashti in Giant. But I was married to Kenneth E. Rare, one of the four freshmen. And Kenneth had given up a very lucrative career because they were the top vocal group in the nation when
we
got married.
Oh, tell me. Yes, they were.
And so, of course, I had three children from my first marriage. So he said, I cannot be on the road and be a proper father, mm-hmm. which I loved and appreciated his attitude very much. So he said, I will do something else. So because of my holdings in real estate, he was very interested in real estate also. So he decided to go into that and study law. So I said, good gravy, if you're going to study law, that's 8 to 10 hours of just reading every day. And to me, you can't do anything unless you do it right or don't even bother. So I said, I will go back to work part-time. He said, what in the world can you ever do part-time? Because I jump in feet first and give it 100% of
how nifty of you to say that.
Why?
Well, I mean, that's pretty nifty for you to say, hey, you know, you go do that 8-10 hours a day and give it the full shot and don't worry about anything else. I'll go back to work for a while.
You can't
terrific.
You can't do, I don't think, really well. You can't do two jobs at once really well.
Mm-hmm.
And with all of the reading and everything new he had to learn, to me, that was the only way. So, as usual, we did what we always do. We put it into prayer. So we had a family gathering, and I said, Lord, here I am again. And you know what my needs are, and I just know that something will happen to come along. I don't expect you to do my work for me. I'll certainly go out and look for a job, but I have to let people know. And the only thing I really know is show business.
Mm-hmm.
So I was hoping to get a part-time job in show business. So I was doing a show in Canada to relieve a friend of mine. It was a Christian broadcasting show. And she had laryngitis and asked me to replace her. So I did, and while I was up there, as usual, I call home every night to check on the kids.
Sure.
And Kenneth said that somebody's been trying to get you from New York about another commercial, because I had turned down a lot of commercials. Because to me, unless you really believe in something, whether it's a commercial or a show or a film or a play, anything.
You can't fool the audience.
You can't do it.
No.
I can. No. There's no way I can.
I mean, you and I have both watched endorsements for products by big names in our business.
Yes.
And you know they're conning us, that they're doing it for the buck. And they really couldn't care less about the product. All right. So anyway.
Okay. So they right away I call and I said, first of all, what's your product? And they said, Comet Cleanser. I said, good gravy. I've been using that for 3 years and it really is the best. But now, wait a minute. You don't want me to be one of those housewives that says, hi there. I'm one of your happy housewives, and have I got something for you? No way. I can't do that. That's not my ballgame.
Or the guy comes home and, well, the sink's dirty. What are we going to
do about
that?
Right. No way, no. They said, well, no, this is a little bit different. This is a character part. I said, well, that's great. I've been playing characters all my life. What is this one? They said, it's a lady plumber. Well, from the minute they said Lady Plumber, it sounded like it would be fun, it would be interesting, mm-hmm. and it was honest because I really used the product. I said, I'd like to test for it. They mm-hmm. said, you mean you'd test for it? I said, of course I'll be glad to test for it. Otherwise, how in the world are you going to...
Are we going to know if it looks right?
If it looks right or not. So I later found out I was the 103rd lady that tested for it. And I went back at the same time on the plane with two other marvelous ladies. In fact, one, a darling lady that we became very good friends, Patsy Garrett, who's in all the Benji shows, you know.
Oh, surely.
In fact,
surely.
Now Patsy is doing, she's got three commercials on right now. It's fantastic. But anyway, because of that, we became good friends. And of course, I said, now look, you know, if it's whosever turn it is, we'll get it.
Yep.
And I'm a great believer in that. I really am. If something is right for you and it's meant to happen, by gum, nothing in the world will stand in your way. So I prayed for them when they did their, you know, their test, and they said they prayed for me. But I really believed when I went back there that this would solve our family problem. This was what was meant to be, you know. Mm-hmm. And sure enough, it was, because we were the longest running commercial at that time in the history of television.
What'd you do, 12 years?
12 years.
And what fun, because
it
I'm sure
fantastic.
Everywhere you went, people said, hey, it is Josephine.
They still do.
Yeah.
It's really wild.
Uh-huh.
You know, I can be walking down the street and somebody will yell out of a truck, hey, Josephine, got your tools with you? You know, I carry, you saw that handbag of mine. You know, I always
sure.
carry.
May I tell the audience, she came in with a handbag tonight, and Barbara Delgado, who's on our staff here, said, well, here, let me help you with that, and whoom. What you got in there, the money?
I'm sorry, Barbara. Oh, no. Just stuff and things, you mm-hmm. know, pictures of all my children, all the grandbabies,
uh-huh.
everything, you know. Hey, I'm a grandmother again.
You're kidding.
Yes, fourth time, and we finally now, Bill, that's my oldest son, they have a little girl, Amy. I haven't seen her yet, but, Amy,
and,
hope to see you soon.
And is your last name Withers?
Oh, no, Moss.
Aunt, oh, Amy Moss.
Amy Moss.
Even better,
yes.
Short on the marquee.
Oh, Tom. Oh, no, of all my kids, there are only two, really, that are kind of in show business. And my youngest son, Kenneth Edward E. Rare II, he's with A&M Records.
Mm-hmm.
And my youngest daughter, Kendall Janie Rare. See, Moss is from my first marriage.
Okay.
So my three older kids are Moss, and the last two are E-Rare. And Kendall Janie's with Western Costume, and she wants to be a costumer
okay.
on films. And I think she's going to do a terrific job, and Kenny, too.
But Amy Moss in. Looks good, Jane. Looks good. We will be right back. I want to go over and sit in the throne here, and you tell all the stuff
great,
you want. Okay, we'll
to.
Be right back with Jane Withers after these words from our sponsors.
Some guests on The Tomorrow Show stay at the Sheraton Universal Hotel, a Sheraton Showplace Hotel. For reservations, call free 800-325-3535 or have your travel agent call.
Comfortable, I might add.
Skills to go with these things?
Too. I don't know.
I don't know either.
Here we are on the Jane Withers suite. What is all this stuff? Now, start over here in this area. And now, wait a second. I want to see if we got a monitor here so that we can see. So that we're talking about the same thing that people at home are seeing.
Oh, yes, good gravy. That's very important.
All right.
Okay?
I think we see these dolls, huh?
Yeah.
Just nod your head. Yeah, these over here, Janie.
Okay. Now, may I go down there?
Sure.
Okay,
you can,
it's a lot easier. Well, I can't?
Sure you can. Go ahead.
Okay.
Go ahead. I'll pull your cord in a manner of speaking.
Okay, down here. This was my last trip to Russia. I was there in May with a group called Bibles for the World. We went on a very special mission. And while there, I was privileged to get this collection, not the Kewpie and not these. This was from my Canadian trip when I did some Christian shows there about 4 or 5 weeks ago, and I acquired these Eskimo dolls there that I'm very, very proud of. And these are actually, I must show you these because they're kind of marvelous. They're tea cozy dolls.
Oh, look
this
here.
Fits over a pot of tea. Isn't that marvelous?
Uh-huh.
Look at that super face.
Yeah.
I love her expression.
Yeah.
I think that's great fun. I love Kewpies. I've always been mad about Kewpies. Now, somewhere here is my little Kewpie doll that's been with me all over the world. I don't know where they put her, but anyway, I brought it. But it's about this big. This is the largest one of my Kewpie dolls, and the one that I carry with me is about this big.
Where did you find the Chaplin doll?
The Chaplin doll was a gift to me from a fan. That's how I acquired most all of my dolls, from all those lovely people out there that
mm-hmm.
just send them to me, you know, which I absolutely treasure. And that doll was just on exhibit with the Mary Pickford doll over there that I borrowed tonight only from Mary to share with you because she's such an extraordinary
doll. Can I pick it up gently and bring
it
over here?
Yes,
because the
dying to share. This doll, again, was made for Mary by a fan, which I think is extraordinary. And that's the lovely thing about collecting dolls, are all of the incredibly gifted, talented people that have this talent of making, you know, their own thing and sharing it with you, just like these two dolls that a fan sent to me by the name of Betty Grime. Now, she also makes miniatures, and she made me my smallest teddy bear that's in a nutshell. It's the cutest thing you ever saw. I brought it, too, but it's so teensy, I don't think they can see it.
Well, if we find it, we'll show.
But anyway, this is supposed to be Shirley and me from Bright Eyes.
Uh-huh.
They were supposed to have a still to go with it, I think about the same time of me running over Shirley in the baby buggy.
I don't see it there. I don't see it on the monitor, Janie, so I don't think we've got it.
Now, okay, dear, that's
what about these costumes that are up here in back of us?
Oh, those were both used in the original Ben-Hur and the second version of Ben-Hur. And those are both, my dear, they weigh a ton to try to pick them up. I don't know how in the world the men ever wore them in battle, let alone in a movie.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, that's what those are. Now this, my dear.
Here, bring it right out here.
This belonged to Cary Grant, one of
You're
my
kidding.
Super favorites. No, not
Judy,
at all.
Judy.
Now this was Cary's original, I'm told, because I bought it at auction from the Screen Smart Set, which is a wonderful organization that any of you folks that have never been must go. It's fantastic. They have all kinds of goodies from the stars from all over Hollywood, everything from clothes to things from their home, and all the monies go to the Motion Picture and Television Relief Fund to aid them in their hospital, which of course is very important. So anything they get of Cary Grant's, they know I'm a sucker and I'll pay anything to get that.
Now, you got a pair of slippers over here I want to just bring to you.
Oh, those are Jack Benny's.
Well, you gave it away. I was going to say, JB, who is that?
I'm sorry. These were Jack Benny's shoes, which I treasure. And there again, those were at auction about 2 years ago from the Screen Smart Set. I get an awful lot of things from them because naturally, a lot of the stars donate their things to them because it helps our home there,
okay,
you know, for the older actors and actresses.
Now, the dress behind you, this big...
Oh, that's an extraordinary gown. This was designed, can you see it, by Helen Rose, who used to design all my clothes when I was a child.
Okay.
Which means a great deal to me. This was designed, here's the sketch of it, the original sketch, of Leslie Caron in the glass slipper.
Mm-hmm.
And this dress I got for my youngest daughter, Kendall, for her 16th birthday, and she modeled it then for a special showing of Helen Rose creations. I'm sorry she couldn't model it tonight.
Now, looking around here, Jane, pick a couple of things that have interesting stories. You know stuff, and I don't.
Well,
the straw hat here.
Oh, the straw hat's very special. That belonged to W.C. Fields.
Oh, it did.
Yes, it did. And I'm very thrilled to have that because when I was doing extra work on W.C. Fields' film, It's a Gift, he was wearing that hat. And he picked me out to do a scene with him. It was just a bit part, but I worked with him, and he picked me out to do it. And then after the picture was over, and in fact, several years later, I acquired that hat from Mr. Fields after I became a child star.
What about the Popeye dolls?
Well, that has no great meaning, except that it's just... except I love Popeye, and for a doll collector, it's special because it's an old rubber original doll in mint condition.
Is there anybody that you've ever wanted to work with in your life that you haven't been able to?
Oh, boy, and how. Oh, how much time do we have?
Hours. Eons.
Hours.
Go, Jane.
Oh, gosh. I've always wanted to work with Cary Grant, Jimmy Stewart, Deborah Carr, Tony Randall, Jack Lemmon, Jiminy, Orson Welles.
Mm-hmm.
I'm the biggest movie fan in the world, in the whole wide world. And I love Henry Winkler of the new
new
group. Yeah, the Fonz. He's a lovely person. We have done benefits together, a lot of benefits together. And we worked together in Hawaii for Easter Seals. That's where I first met him. And in fact, there's a story that I know I'm going to be doing it next year as a 2-hour special for television.
What's it about?
It's a wonderful story. I'm so thrilled because I think it will open monumental doors to a better understanding about autistic children and animals working with children.
Oh, is this where the doggies...
This is a true story. It was in the Reader's Digest when I first saw it, and then Mr. Levinson acquired the rights to the script, and Alan Sloan has done the first screenplay for it, the first draft of the screenplay, and we're very excited about it, and it's going to be done next year as a 2-hour special.
You know, I've heard you mention here tonight that you pray for this. And you pray. Are you a born-again person, or have you always been?
Well, I tell you, Mama, I think one of the greatest gifts that my mother and father ever gave me was the fact that, and taught me at a very early age, that God was my partner. And I have often wondered, Tom, what in the world would have happened to me with all I've been through all my life? You know, and it has been rather horrendous sometimes. I was totally paralyzed one time with rheumatoid arthritis. Mm-hmm. And, of course, can do just about anything. In fact, I do more now, I think, than I did then. But I really have always had tremendous faith, and that has carried me through just about everything all my life. And it's meant the world to me. In fact, I just did, which really means a lot to me. I just recorded Mary Pickford's book, which is a beautiful book, and it's called Why Not Try God? And it's been out of print for many years, but I was so thrilled to be able to do that book of Mary Pickford's, because what she says and the way I feel, I don't know, our philosophy just sort of parallel. And I record it on cassette tape, and it's released right now. And you can only get it if you write in. May I say where?
Or is that, why don't you? How about if anybody wants that, if they let us know, and then we'll send it to you, and you'll let them know, or we'll let them know.
That's a lovely idea. All right.
Because otherwise,
because it will help a lot of people. The monies are going to help a lot of people.
You know how NBC gets.
Oh, tell me. I know. Sorry about that. I just love to help people.
Sometimes I think NBC stands for nobody cares.
Oh, yes, they do.
But I know better. Oh, I meant just here. But
I know.
It's a loving company.
You better.
We will be right back. Now, we got the two guys coming on from AFI and the TV
neat.
Academy.
Okay,
we'll talk about
great.
The old films and show the old clips right after these words from our NBC stations. Exactly. Now, easy, Bob.
It got corrupt.
Now, here are Bob Blumhoff, who is with the American Film Institute, and Mr. Robert Lewine, Bob Lewine, who is with the Television Academy. And both of these fellows are interested in preserving shows that have gone before. Well, you tell what it is. You do the films and you do the television.
And yeah, well, I
said it happened one night, but that's not the right.
No, way. It's a wonderful life.
Oh, a wonderful life.
It's a wonderful life. Part
Jimmy
of that,
Stewart,
part
Donna
of that
Reed.
was lost, and part of Lost Horizon,
oh,
from the original
goodness.
Frank Capra one, was lost, and
When you say was lost, Bob, how do these things get lost? I made a pass at trying to describe what this nitrate film is, but I'm not really conversant.
No, you did fine. You did very, very well. Until 1951, practically all film was shot and reproduced on nitrate film, which, as you pointed out, is terribly perishable.
Mm-hmm.
And so we now have some of that nitrate film left. We estimate that maybe out of all of the films that were shot up to 1951, which means all of the silent films and a good part of the talkie films, at least 50% are lost forever. I mean, let's forget about them. They just
gone.
Are not to be found. A Greta Garbo film that she made with Lars Hansen, I think was made in Sweden years ago, lost. Negative, everything. It's gone, you know?
Do you know what I read about him today? That there was not a 35-millimeter print of Stagecoach around until you found one in John Wayne's garage?
Yeah, the story is a little apocryphal, but basically it's true. Nobody had a 35-millimeter print of John Ford's Stagecoach, one of the great films of all time.
Oh.
There was this 16-millimeter that was playing on TV, but it had been chopped up somewhat, and certainly not the original version that John Ford had made. And part of preservation is sleuthing. You know, you go
mm-hmm.
out, you go looking for things. And somebody happened to be talking to Duke one day, you know? And he said, hey, I got a bunch of my old films, he said, up on a shelf in my garage. He said, I'll take a look and see if I got Stagecoach.
That sounds just
and
like...
he went in there, and there was a print of Stagecoach in perfect state of preservation, and the complete film in 35 millimeter.
What a blessing. Mm.
Lucky.
Now, I'll ask you this second. Well, no, I'll ask you now, what are you looking for? Television?
Yes. From the very beginning, if we can find it, kinescopes didn't really start till about 48 or 49.
Mm-hmm.
So everything prior to that went on the air and was dissolved into thin air. We are going after kinescopes. We have quite a few of them. Studio One, Danger, Suspense. We have a lot of Ed Sullivan shows. And we don't sleuth, as Bob has said, because there's so much of it. It comes to us pretty much just by asking for it.
Yeah, but do you know that when Greg Garrison was putting together the first 50 years of NBC here a year or two ago, he had to run ads in the trades to find shows that were gone?
Sure.
Well, they came to us. NBC came to us, and Milton Berle came to us. We've provided a lot of shows with old material. ABC came to us, and CBS came to us. So I think there's a great value to be had in preserving old television.
So do I. It's the way we were, Bob.
Absolutely.
You know? The commercials of that day are...
But you know, even today, Tom, there's a terrible problem because videotape is the most perishable of all. It's worse than the nitrate film.
What is it, about 10 years?
And they estimate some of them estimate as little as 5 years. Now, what's going to happen? Some of
there
these
are
great...
some I've done, Bob, I wish wouldn't last 10 seconds.
Well, well, I made a few films that I feel that way about.
Right, we all feel that way.
We all have those, you know.
Of course.
Tom, we looked at the first Fred Astaire, Barry Chase special.
Oh, wow.
Remember that?
Oh, do I remember it? Yeah.
And
my man.
There were the Chrysler cars advertised.
Yeah.
Monsters. They looked like Sherman tanks.
Yeah.
But we have the commercial kept in the show because, as you say, it's going to tell us an awful lot about
history.
Our time.
It really is history.
Great joys. You know, I had a fire in a house in New York, and unfortunately, one of the things that went in were bound volumes of Life magazine from 1936 to 46 with all those ads for all the old toothpaste and tooth powders and Burma Shave.
I have them, and I love them.
Aren't they fantastic?
They're more fun.
I know it. And once you lose it, it's gone.
It's gone.
I want to ask, and I want to show the movies, but I've got commercials. We will continue after these words from our sponsors. We're going to show you movies, and I want to find out, when you find an old nitrate, what do you do with it? We'll be right back.
Well, fortunately, this business is made.
We're back on, but tell that little story you told about going to Reno.
Oh, well, I was just saying I had done some benefits for Bob for the monies that were received, not to me, but for their organization, in transferring the film from nitrate into tape or whatever.
To acetate.
Acetate, pardon me.
Is that what you do?
That's what you do. You transfer from nitrate to acetate. But it's a very expensive thing.
Nitrate's also very... flammable, very explosive.
Oh, highly. Explosive, combustible, you know.
You've worked, I think, for all three networks.
Yes.
Okay. You are a rare bird.
Fred Silverman and I, the only two.
Yeah, that's true. He's another one who's worked for all three. Mm-hmm. I know many who've worked for two out of the three.
Yeah.
And some that I wish worked for one of the other two, but few that worked for all three.
Yeah.
Is there a policy of the television networks now, or was there when you were with them, about what they save and what they don't, or do they just throw it all out?
No, Tom, the volume of material that passes through just one network's time periods from 7 in the morning to 1 in the morning, 2
Say
in the
two.
Morning.
Say 2.
2.
Good.
Excuse me. Is so vast that in no time at all, their warehouses were just filled with it. Plus the fact that in the early days of tape, it was expensive to keep buying new tape. So they would erase tapes and reuse them.
Yeah.
I chaired a committee at NBC to decide what would be erased and what wouldn't be. And it was like cutting my own flesh to say, take that and
We moved from New York, we had, I don't know how many hours, 900, and we had to sit down and reduce it to 50, and you'd just die.
Oh, well, I couldn't
but
do that.
Where do you put it?
No way. Yeah.
The only solution to that, of course, is to tape on one of your own Betamax or a Sony or a Panavision.
Mm.
And save them that way, but who can afford that?
Have you heard the great story about Among and the Night Visitors?
No.
Well, I don't know if this is true or not, but, you know, Among and the Night Visitors was a classic here with NBC. You know, Giancarlo Minotti's
Giancarlo Minotti,
Christmas Opera. Okay, Hallmark Hall of Fame, 50s.
Yeah.
So one day, the general decided, Sarnoff, this isn't when he was alive, that he wanted to see a screening of Among and the Night Visitors, and this was in July. So they ran it through the videotape machine to make sure everything was okay, and they rewound it. And they called and they said, is the general ready to see the show now? And they said, the general is waiting. The guy in videotape rolled the tape, and it was black.
Oh.
Okay? When they ran it through the machine, somebody forgot to turn off the erase button.
Oh.
And
oh my
history, God. They had to do it all over again.
Oh, good heavens.
Lord.
He isn't still there, is he, well, that engineer?
I don't know.
I really don't know.
Well, see, this
the general was upset, though, I heard.
I understand that.
This just happened in connection with the probe of Venus. They turned the radar antenna the wrong way, and they lost the pictures that were coming in.
Oh,
it's going to take, they're going to be able to recapture them, but it'll take 6 months before they can get them again. So it happens.
Say, listen, I want to get these two little clips on, and you know what they are.
Yes,
not set them up here, and then don't roll it yet, George.
Yeah. Well, the first one is from the year 1917, and it's a trailer for a Pearl White serial. After she had made Perils of Pauline and had become the queen of serials, the queen of cliffhangers, as we used to call them. And she's just a beautiful woman, too, and quite remarkable.
All right, it's going to pop up on the screen here, Bob. I think on yours, too, over here. And
all right.
You'll have to narrate this because
that's no problem.
It has no sound.
Adults, 20 cents.
Yeah, that was a logo for imagine getting into a theater for 20 cents.
Won't see that time again.
Now there is.
And this was an ad for the upcoming episode.
It was a trailer. It was that goes in 1917. Even they were using trailers. And,
National Screen Service.
I think it was before National Screen, but there she is, and she's a remarkable looking woman. And of course she's always running away from danger.
Mm-hmm.
And each Saturday she was left hanging on some kind of cliff. Literally or figuratively, and then next week. Now this.
Joseph P. Kennedy.
Oh, Joseph P. Kennedy, the father of President Kennedy and of Senators Bobby and Ted.
Mm-hmm.
He was very active in the film business during the 1920s, and he had this young man, Bob Steele, whom he was going to promote as a big Western star. And this was his trailer to introduce Bob Steele to the world.
Hi there, girls.
Look at that. Note that Barrymore profile.
Barrymore profile. Wow.
Isn't that marvelous?
Oh, that's
that is great.
Yeah.
Well, those are the things that are worth preserving.
I think so.
They're priceless.
They are priceless.
You know, plus, just one thing I'd like to say, and that is that I think most people don't realize that really today film has arrived. It is the American art form of today.
Mm-hmm.
And you talk to a man like Frank Capra, for example, and Frank will tell you that all other arts are subordinate to film because film combines all of the other arts, and it's potential is infinite. You know, you stop a piece of film in a moviola, and in that one frame is the whole of life and the whole of the universe.
Well, we television people might argue that a little bit, but we might walk halfway out the door and then come back in. Say, what is lost? Is the Goldbergs lost?
No. I operate under the theory, Tom, that almost every show has a home somewhere. Prints are liberated by a director, a writer, and placed in a closet, a garage. But to go out and ask these people would take, 10 years.
I've liberated several shows.
I have too, I told you about the Astaire show.
Gentlemen, may I just share one thought?
Sure. I got 15 seconds this year. Go ahead.
Yeah. Oh, but we've got the greatest medium in the world right here to bring the world closer together.
Sure.
And when you need something, the good Lord says, ask and you shall receive. So if you need it, ask it. I know those folks out there, they'll help you. They'll never let you down.
Yeah. Well, That's worked so far. We get more than we can handle.
I know where you can get 5 never before seen episodes of the Montefuscos. Let me stop for a second. We'll be right back to say goodnight to these terrific people after these words from our NBC stations. I really want to thank Jane Withers for sharing many of her treasures with us tonight. You
thank
are a dear, dear, and we will see you shortly again,
thank
I hope.
You. I've had a lovely time.
Okay, and Mr. Bob Lewine and Mr. Bob Blumhoff from the Television Academy and the American Film Institute, respectively, for being here. I really enjoyed meeting you all.
Thank you, Tom.
It's just been a fantastic hour for us all.
Enjoyed it too.
Thank you. Thank you all for watching, and good night, everybody.